call the order. Can we have a roll call, please?
All right, Ms. Barrett? Ms. Zemtich?
Here.
Ms. Hubbard?
Present.
Mr. Jacobs? Dr. Sophia? Mr. Marshall?
Here.
Ms. Mendelson?
Here.
Mr. Newman?
Here.
Dr. O'Donnell? Ms. Green?
Here.
Dr. Smith?
Here.
Ms. Spencer? Mr. James?
Present.
We have...
Very good.
And the flag ready.
Who would pledge allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, do we have a motion for adoption of December 18th minutes? Has been had.
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
All in. Okay. We'll have our first call in the audience. With that, I have, if you're going to talk, please fill out a sheet. The first person is Justin Pope. No, you're on the agenda. Oh, by the way, please, everybody, turn your cell phones off.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, I hope you've had a chance to review the new rescue agreement that's on the agenda today. I'm going to address a few concerns about the second bullet point. It reads, PAC staff and rescue partners agree to make no inflammatory public statements about PAC staff and programs, volunteers, and PAC rescue partners. First, who does this apply to? PAC staff is pretty clear, but is rescue partners defined? Does this apply to the representative of the rescue that signs this agreement? Would it then apply to anything that individual says in any public interaction? Or does it apply to the entity of the organization itself, the rescue's webpage, Facebook, their educational handouts, fundraiser materials, and the representatives of that rescue who, while they're actively representing that rescue, such as at adoption events, but not their personal lives? Or does it apply to every individual who's associated with that rescue and every communication or interaction we ever have with anyone? Second, what is inflammatory? Webster's defines inflammatory as causing anger. That's pretty broad. Is stating that STR dogs are at risk of euthanasia inflammatory? Is standing here objecting to the wording of this agreement inflammatory? It might be if you're the one that wrote it. Some of my fellow rescuers would consider this agreement inflammatory. Last, I would just like to comment that the consequences of this agreement are one-sided. Although nowhere in this agreement does it actually state what the purpose of this agreement is, I think we can assume that his rescue is the privilege to pull animals from PAC. This means that if a rescue breaks this agreement, PAC can resolve this agreement and we lose that privilege. On the other hand, if PAC breaks this agreement, we can dissolve this agreement, but once again, we lose that privilege. I ask you to please address these concerns during this agenda item today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Pope. Marcy Millen.
County in a similar flavor that I wanted to make comments about the partnership agreement. It did seem what, like most of the bullet points apply to what the rescue partners needed to do, and only one or two applied to what PAC was going to do. I know you can't put policies in an agreement like this because policies need to change. They need to be general and change, and this is an agreement that shouldn't have to be redone too often. But I think things like the ability to pull animals, it doesn't say what the rescues are agreeing to, or what PAC's agreeing for the rescue to do, like pull animals. One of the current policies that I would hope would be permanent was that they could always pull any animal off out of Pima Animal Care Center. It was never limited, hasn't been limited to only certain animals. So some general, I think this is a good opportunity to work out a mutual agreement that asks the rescues what they would like to see included in an agreement, rather than it did seem to be pretty much one-sided to me. Thank you.
Thank you. Leanne Kelly?
I'm here also to talk about the rescue agreement, the partner agreement is what it's called. I wholeheartedly agree with what Marcy said, and I also have issues with what Justin Cole put up. But I wanted to bring to attention to one of the items about the 501c3s. They are targeted, they are discriminated against in this agreement, considering that there's only 66% of the rescues are 501c3 for PAC. So having that in there and having the other rescue partners in there, what consequences do they have? Some of the wording about this, both the county and the Arizona Revised Statutes are pretty clear. They say that a duly incorporated humane society or other nonprofit corporate animal welfare organization devoted to welfare protection and humane treatment of animals, that's the county ordinance. The state defines a shelter as a duly incorporated humane society, pretty much the same language. So if you're going to have rescue partners that are not incorporated and 501c3s pulling from PAC, the language has to be universal. It has to not discriminate against the 501c3s like it does in this one. Yes, there's issues in here, and there's things that they talk about, the language about political activity and lobbying. We are very limited in what we can do in those. Fundraising and charitable contributions is mentioned. We're again, we're limited and we have to follow IRS guidelines. If we're not following these IRS guidelines, it seems to me that PAC is saying they're going to enforce this against us when it should be the IRS that enforces it. It should be the IRS that determines whether or not we violated these sanctions on here. The other issue is the adoption coming into our organization and looking at our adoption records and our sterilization records. I have no problem with the sterilization records. But I do have an issue with coming in and breaking my privacy and the privacy laws about finding out who I adopt animals to. PAC has to trust that the rescues are doing their job and finding suitable homes for these animals. We can't get the same information from PAC, and I really don't think PAC should be trying to get that information from us. I don't want to have to tell my doctor, so by the way, PAC might come in and audit my records, and your information is going to go to PAC. I don't think that's going to be taken very well. And I have some other issues that can't be addressed here in the open lobby. So I don't know who you want to be able to listen to.
My concern is also primarily revolved today around the partnership agreement, and I would just say that I agree with a lot of the concerns that were brought up. In addition, though, I'd like to say that I just think that in general, in addition to those things, the verbiage needs to be tightened up. Things like inflammatory is a pretty broad spectrum. There's not a lot of, you know, it needs more definition than that, as does some of the other things in here. Also, to bring complaints or disputes to the attention of, that needs to be clarified as well. It needs to be someone who has some authority and able to arbitrate matters. Stakeholders, and the very last bullet thing, it struck me as real wrong, just as verbiage. I'd like to see it a little more consistent with verbiage in that we could determine, with this form, it looked to me like this form was trying to be developed as a boilerplate form so it could be used for different things, but yet taken all in one thing. And the verbiage could be boilerplate by referring to everybody as community partners or rescue partners and just defining who falls under that category to fit into this form. My other issue that I wanted to bring up or concern was that in looking at the donations that are coming in, we get a pretty detailed report of donations, but I don't see anything that details out any expenditures for those donations. I don't know where those fall into the expenses category. So that's something that I kind of want to see.
Thank you. Okay. With that, we'll move to old business. The very first agenda item is the volunteer policy and partnership agreement. I'd like to open that up for discussion.
The inflammatory thing, as an adoption counselor and a foster, I have to tell people we have an open return policy, so I have to say I need the dog to come back to our organization so it doesn't go to PAC. Not that I think you're not going to take care of the dog, but that can be inflammatory, like, you know. So I don't want to inflame anybody. Justin made a lot of good points. I heard 6 or 7 things. I was like,
yes.
Well, I think you could, as an organization that also takes in animals that we receive many from different foster groups and or rescue groups, and we will in most cases call them and let them know that the animal is here. But you could just say when you're doing the adoption that it's our policy that you bring it back. You don't need to say that it doesn't go to PAC or the Humane Society, just say so that it doesn't come, you know.
That was just a quick example.
Yeah.
I'm sure I put that on your list too.
Yeah. Oh.
Just off the top of my tongue, unintentionally, of course.
Any other comments on
that? I don't understand what the problem is. If PAC wants to know who's adopting the animals and the rescues, I don't understand why that is an issue of privacy, because if the animals are being taken to a rescue from PAC, and we're working as a partnership. When people come to PAC and they want to adopt an animal, we have to have information about them. So I don't understand why a rescue would not want to share that information with PAC. It's a sharing issue. The whole idea of having this document is that we're working together as an organization. So I don't understand why we can't share that information. It might be helpful for future references if we share the information of who's adopting the animals. So I don't understand why that would be something that people would be upset about. So you'd have to explain that to me, because I don't understand why that's a negative.
I think we have to keep that as an issue, because if I form a nonprofit tomorrow, decide to adopt whatever, somebody comes to me for a dog, and then coming to you for a dog, and coming to you for a dog, and what are they doing with all these dogs? Or if they're abusers, and I don't know it, you audit my records and say, don't give any more dogs to this person because there's an issue with that person. The only way you're going to know is if you partner and work with each other.
Also, right now, the centers are held accountable for placing those dogs in suitable homes. And the law requires documentation from rescues back to PAC so we can continue to do this. And ultimately, PAC should have that information on the dogs because the dogs are supposed to be licensed. And if it comes through a transfer, because many of these animals are over 3 months of age, which are supposed to be licensed, there should be a transfer from that organization to PAC of ownership. So this should not be an issue. It really shouldn't, because ultimately we're all concerned where these pets are going.
Ms. Schwerin.
It is the law that was passed a few months ago in both the city and the county, that as a condition of any transfer of animals from the animal control center to a rescue organization, the animal control center must verify that the organization must verify a lot of things about this organization. They have to verify that the organization is organized with the pursuit of animal loving activities, is actively engaged in those activities, and does not breed nor release unsterilized animals, releasing animals only through community care programs or through adoption into suitable homes after first being sterilized. That's one of the things, according to law, that the animal care center must verify that these organizations release animals on one way is only through adoption into suitable homes after first being sterilized. So the animal care center must, by law, must verify that. So of course they have to know to whom they were adopted, to whom the animals were adopted. And also it says if the organization, any organization wishing to receive animals must agree in writing to the terms that I just read.
I agree. I agree that a PAC has the obligation as well as the right to do that. One of the issues that I have with this is that I think we need to, or the PAC needs to work out the, there's two. The first issue was on the very first doc, which is to respect, support, and promote the activities of the other PAC partners and the programs of the PAC. So anybody that is a stakeholder, and of course, from my perspective, I'm looking at it from volunteers, that you are obligated to do those things. You must do those. Otherwise, that's the way I see it. The PAC can then terminate your ability to be a volunteer PAC. The other one is the second one down, to make no inflammatory public statements about PAC staff and programs, volunteers, and PAC rescue partners. Now, I think that, personally, I think that infringes on our First Amendment rights, but I've done some research into this, and most of it goes the way that you can't do that. However, they do have the right to stop and not have volunteers that are going to misdirect the where PAC wants to go. I mean, PAC has the right to not have volunteers that are going to sidetrack what its mission is. But I think there's a better way of doing that than having volunteers feel that they can't express themselves about what's going on at PAC or how to change it. And I tend to stay off Facebook and not make commentaries and stuff, but I've noticed when I have gone on it that there are sometimes a thread of communication that isn't good, and it probably should not be that going down that path. I'm not sure how to resolve it. I don't think this is the way to resolve it. I think we can go get there with better language.
Yes. On this point, I think that rather than say no inflammatory statements, blah, 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 if you have a problem, there should be a way to deal with somebody at PAC about the problem. To say, you know, a generalized negative is not going to help PAC, it's not going to help the rescues, and it's not going to help the animals. If you have a specific issue, go to the people who can help you fix that issue and bring it to their attention, rather than these long threads on Facebook that are bashing PAC. Well, all that does is make people not want to come to PAC to rescue animals. And it makes the problem that we have a PAC of too many animals worse. If there's something that you see as a volunteer or as a rescue that you feel is making it difficult for you to work with PAC, there are people to discuss it with. And I think that's the whole point of this type of an agreement, that we're partners in this and we have to work together. Everything at PAC's not perfect, for sure. And if you see something that's wrong, bring it to our attention. That's what we're here for. We have that whole list of bullet points that we talk about every meeting about things that need to be corrected. This is where those issues should be aired, not in public. I mean, not on Facebook. If you want to say it in public, it's fine, but I think on Facebook, it just makes PAC look terrible, and people are not going to come and rescue and adopt animals.
I agree. And usually what happens, what happens is that as a volunteer, you may agree with a smidgen of what is being said in that post or thread, but not all of that, and then it starts getting, it goes really bad. It starts heading in all sorts of directions. So I agree that maybe a structure could be worked out at PAC so that if there, you can't really, it's like, the very person you're having an issue with, maybe, let's say it's the shelter manager, and it's because, who knows what it may be, whatever the issue is. If there is some sort of grievance structure that a person can at least have some point, some way to vocalize what their issue is, they may not get anywhere. It's really not any different than a grievance procedure. It could even be called a grievance procedure for that matter, but it goes and then it's addressed and then it's done rather than the all, because you know what, most of the volunteers aren't seeing that thread anyway, as far as on Facebook. Some are, they're not. But this part looks more like it's a setup to remove volunteers. And that's what it appears. I'm not trying to get it, but that's what it appears in the first read. You can't say anything about this. And otherwise, you're out. And so I think we could work on that language, or we could hope that PAC could work on that language.
It boils down to the next item. We need to engage in respectful communication and dialogue and try to work things out. I mean, it's when there's some inflammatory statements made, either on Facebook or the public is now still saying, oh, PAC's a bad place to go. They kill all the animals. I can't tell you how many people I've said they're working to be no kill. You're looking at 20 years ago. We have a very proactive community and we need to step on board. And every time somebody makes a negative comment about the shelter, it usually is amplified. And so think about how you want to be treated, or say, hey, we've got the situation, let's try to do this proactively. And I know it's taking steps. And when we've got some major growing pains, because there's been a major shift in how things are perceived over the last several years. And so we all have to be respectful. And so if it's taking out this non-inflammatory, just saying respect and then having some procedures in place, like here, if people are afraid to come here and speak to us in person, they can submit a letter. And I don't know if we have a complaint box or something, so if it's anonymous, if they're afraid of retaliatory measures, there should be some form of communication methods that somebody can use so that we don't have to be so negative and stir the pot, basically, and maybe we keep everything to a working rate between volunteers, between public, between staff, the advisory committee. So,
we have a volunteer coordinator, and that person, I remember when Jose was the volunteer coordinator, and we were growing rather quickly at that time, he had to walk this fine line. He wasn't necessarily management, but he kind of represented both sides. So when volunteers were going to him all the time about issues that are going on at PAC, and so then he would give his opinion or explain it to the volunteers, what's going on, why. And then sometimes the volunteers had a very valid point and he would then take it on up. And I remember I noticed that many times he would talk to you about it. And we really don't have that much right now. Not that much is going through that person. And we don't see him very often. So I think that could be a good way to start utilizing him again, because that worked pretty well. In fact, that we didn't have so much Facebook notoriety either on that. Airing our dirty laundry, you know, publicly and things like that. Ms. Mendez.
Where it says bring complaints and disputes to, rather than a specific person, can we have at least two positions so that if they don't get along with person A, they can take it to person B? Because if you say bring it to Joe Smith and Joe Smith quits, then they've got to figure out who it is rather than can I talk to the kennel manager or somebody by position if they, you know, lose a person. But at least have one to one option for whom they can go to.
I see it as basically just being able to air it from more than just the one person that said, let's do it this way. But to me, the ultimate decision is still PAC's. They are managing PAC. They have to ultimately make that decision, and if they say no, you try all the steps possible. You wanted to get it across to as many people. If you mentioned it to the person in charge, whatever, And they still, no, we're not going to be done that path. And that's it. You're done.
Yeah, but doesn't everybody have a supervisor?
They do, but you can bring it. But rather than then go on and on and on.
Oh, I didn't mean to.
No, I mean, in any type of grievance, it's finalized eventually. You know, it's either denied.
Well, yeah.
And then you have a right to, I guess, arbitrate it. We're not saying arbitration. It's eventually going to be agreed to or not. And then we move on rather than get bogged down forever on that one issue, because I wouldn't want that.
Well, the fourth one just says to take it till it doesn't.
Sure, no, no, we can do that, yeah.
I think this is a really, really, really good start. Maybe some of the wording could be changed, but my question is this something that the advisory committee is going to vote on, or is this just something that's brought to our attention?
I'm not sure. Mr. Jay?
Ms. Hubbard, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, I don't know if this would fall. The committee can take whatever action it would like to provide that advice to the manager and or supervisor. It could be a letter. You've taken many different forms. Sometimes it's just saying, look, we hear this. You've provided input here tonight. Great advice, sound advice, and positions and examples that will be taken by the management. And each one of these meetings, in essence, is you providing your thoughts, your feelings, your advice as an advisory council to the management team. And if you want to make it a little stronger, you could put it in writing, you could take a motion and make it a matter of motion. But it's now on public record that the speaker's interests are also there, all for advice to the management. So that's a long answer to. As an advisory committee, you will leave it to us, and if you want to make a motion to put emphasis on it, to advise the management to do specific things or even general things with this item on the agenda, you have the that's purely up to your preference.
Mr. Mark, back to the Facebook. I'm not trying to play devil's advocate, but a lot of the posts I see are an emotional response to something that happened that day or that week, and these volunteers, which some of them I feel are probably indispensable at what they do. By having that emotional output, it's cathartic for them, and they feel a little bit better, but then also they commiserate, and they have shared experiences. From that, it produces some positive conversations and solutions, ultimately. I'm not one to go out there and post everything or reply to everything, but at the same time, I do like to monitor and read it. I met some great people. I guess I'm not Facebook friends with the people that write down, "Pack kills all the dogs," or whatever their fear is going to get written. A lot of it's like, this happened to this particular dog or this particular cat, and from there, 40 comments later, something's positive about it the next day.
Well, I think if that's your perception, I think maybe that's the perception of everybody, so this shouldn't be a problem. What number, bullet number two, wouldn't be a problem if that's what's going on. So why not leave it the way it is?
It's inflammatory, it's so subjective.
Yeah. My perspective is reading it like that is leaving it to interpretation that may end up harming volunteers, that someone could just take the wrong action. I think it could be cleaned up and made to express itself better than that.
If I volunteer for my organization, who I'm just a volunteer for, my wife, same house, foster dogs, da da da, she has something to say. Can she say it? You know what I mean? Like, because that's inflammatory. Does it reflect that on me? Am I kicked out? Is the organization kicked out? I don't know. Mm-hmm. Risky.
But, and I, from dealing with PAC a lot, I haven't even heard that type of talk. We're going to kick volunteers out. I haven't heard anything like that, so I didn't want to convey that that's going on. But as you set things up, I'm always looking for the foundation for anything. And rather than move down that path and get that going, it's best just not to go there. You don't have to go there. Management runs PAC. They have the final say on everything. We give advice, you know, we can give strong advice, whatever. But nonetheless, they still have to make the final decision. So when it comes to the reason I think it's such a big deal is because PAC is not staffed the way they'd like to be, and it doesn't seem like they're going to be in the foreseeable future. And volunteers do a huge part of what PAC needs to get done. And that's part of the reason why they're so vocal, I think, is that they're so involved with everything. So I don't think we should just try and make things worse by their own. Any other commentaries on that before I move on? Mr. James, would you like to? I'd like to allow Dr. Garcia to say something. I mean, he was going to say something with what you were saying, I believe.
Of course. You bet, Dr. Garcia.
Thank you. Mr. Chair, members of the advisory committee, thank you for having us, as always. I wanted to sort of just remind us of the context of the documents that we submitted to you, and really as a starting off point, as a draft, to start to generate some of this conversation. I really am appreciative of the comments that Kim, Justin, Marcy, and Ann all made, some of them really excellent points. And trust me, part of the whole process here today is to get that kind of feedback. And if we can get that kind of feedback in writing, it's actually even better. So, but I have taken notes, and we will have the notes that are memorialized by Mike Schleter. So just the other piece to remind you is when it says, when you say it feels sort of like a boilerplate, we've been struggling with this. We've been struggling with, should this just be for, we don't think that we should signal any one partner out or class of partners. It's not just for rescue groups, it's not just for volunteers, maybe for a range of stakeholders. I agree that some of the language may not be as refined, inflammatory, a fairly broad word, and we will work on that. But thank you, this is exactly the kind of feedback that we wanted. As part of the guidance that you provided last week, one of the conversations that is starting, one of the conversations is being facilitated by the rescue coordinator, is a meeting to bring some of the rescue organizations around. There's also another kind of conversation that's happening to get the rescue organizations to talk to the volunteers, to talk to some of the other stakeholders, so that we are all in the same room, and so that we are all understanding when we're giving slightly conflicting or largely conflicting counsel and advice. So, A, we're really appreciative. This is exactly the kind of feedback that we needed. I've taken a bunch of notes. And no, our purpose is not to infringe on people's free speech rights, but rather to make sure that the communication is as respectful as possible, and that does not verge on a personal attack or an attack of an organization, whether it be a rescue partner, we know that partners get attacked all the time, or whether it be an individual. So that was the purpose of it. That was all I wanted to share. Is there anything else that we need to look at?
In regards to it feeling like we're going to, like we're using this as a way to get rid of it, to get rid of partners, volunteers, any of that. As Jack mentioned earlier, none of this is capable. We largely rely on our volunteer or rescue partners. None of this is capable. What we're really attempting to do, or what this was the first draft of, was some sort of partnership that we can actually all work together more closely to ultimately save more lives and reach all of our like collaborative goals.
That's a really important point, and Mr. Chairman, members of the advisory committee, and Humane Society is really a good example of an organization that's been able to sort of channel in a very focused, defined way their volunteer energy. And deliver a very exemplary level of service. That's part of the reason we sort of consider them kind of the standard that we all aspire to. So that's the goal here. So, but I, as always, say that nothing that we do at PAC we can do without our volunteers and without our other partners, stakeholders, rescue groups specifically. We just can't do it. So those were all the comments. Thank you.
Thank you.
So instead of reserving the right to dissolving partnership at sole discretion in terms of partnership fulfilling, it's kind of a one way. Could it be more of like a conversation is had, like you go to the principal's office before you go to detention, like you have this This needs to stop, like a cease and desist before it becomes the sole discretion to terminate this partnership. I think that was a quote to the Pima. Either party. But dogs, cats suffer either way.
I'm not saying that.
We could, but then you're out of the cold.
But I've been called to the office many times, I think it was this week, so. Let's move on, are we done with this subject? Anybody else have any more comments? Okay, the next issue is, and we have a guest speaker on this, is the general criteria required for PAC to respond and investigate a service slash welfare issue wherein an animal is in distress. That was initially put on the agenda by Ms. Entage and Ms. Schrein, and there is a guest speaker from their organization, and Ms. Jessica Gray, that will speak to us in 15 minutes. Ms. Gray?
Thank you for your time today, Mr. Chairman of the Board. I'm here today to address two specific instances in which PAC officers failed to very clearly enforce county and city codes and ordinances for animals experiencing severe neglect. One officer even went as far as to assist an offender in obtaining drastic surgical remediation for the direct result of the owner's neglect of his animal. And furthermore, he also failed to see the animal in question receive even the most basic aftercare for that amputation. I received calls as a volunteer with People for Animals, and in one such call on or around the 4th of December, I became aware of the suffering of an unneutered, unvaccinated, and unlicensed pit bull mix named Chewy, belonging to a Mr. Dale Zupp. Mr. Zupp informed me that on or around November 10th, Chewy burst through a screen door, severing his Achilles tendon and lacerating his leg to the bone. Mr. Zupp presented the dog to Southern Arizona Vet Services and was referred to Counselor Nancy Impton with People for Animals, who, in accordance with the veterinarian's recommendation, authorized euthanasia for Chewy in lieu of a nearly $3,000 operation that was well outside of People for Animals care provisioning guidelines. Mr. Zupp chose to take Chewy home that night. He also chose to not provide Chewy any further medical care until he contacted me nearly a month later. After providing two separate appointments for Chewy that Mr. Zupp failed to arrive at, I chose to contact him and give Chewy and himself a ride to BCA. When Chewy got in the truck, the overwhelming odor of decomposition came with him. At the vet, Dr. Avon of BCA found she had to soak the bandage off of Chewy's leg as it was molded on like a cast despite being soft bandage material with pus and fluids from the wound. At this time, I informed Mr. Zupp that because of his neglect of Chewy and failure to provide even the most basic pet needs, only euthanasia would be offered through our program. Mr. Zupp also likes to regularly state that he is homeless and jobless and plans on staying that way. Mr. Zupp began yelling at that time and announcing his intention to further deprive Chewy of veterinary care. Dr. Avon wrapped Chewy's leg, changed her story regarding what was good for this dog from what she and I had discussed in an adjacent exam room, and sent Mr. Zupp to the waiting room with Chewy. I contacted Animal Control at this time and reported not only Chewy's previous blatant neglect and direct and willful violation of several city, county, and state laws regarding provisioning of veterinary care for his dog, as well as his violations regarding vaccination and licensing. Mr. Jose Chavez spoke with the veterinarian, and both of them very cleverly and carefully worded the scenario to suit themselves, rendering Mr. Chavez with no further work to do regarding this case at the moment, and Dr. Avon free of the highly obnoxious and odoriferous situation in her lobby. Chewy did not get help that day. Later in the week, we got Animal Control to respond to a location Mr. Zupp had been staying at and force him to provide Chewy with a vet visit. People for Animals was again contacted by Mr. Zupp at this time, as he has no means to provide care for Chewy. I myself transported Chewy and Mr. Zupp to Valley Animal Hospital, where the veterinarian presented amputation or euthanasia as the only reasonable care plans for Chewy. Mr. Zupp was informed that People for Animals would not authorize amputation, not only because of our long-held policies against it as a program-assisted course of treatment, but also due to Mr. Zupp's constant failure to provide Chewy with any kind of aftercare for his injuries. Mr. Zupp expressed his intention to leave with Chewy without any further care, and I again contacted Animal Control. At this time, Mr. Chavez hastily and aggressively informed me that a private donor would pay for the amputation for Chewy. I expressed my concerns about aftercare for this painful procedure, and Chavez assured me there would be follow-up to see Chewy did not suffer any further. To date, there is no record of further animal control contact, and the veterinarians assure us Chewy has not arrived for any, even his first, aftercare appointment. The condition of this dog is not known at this time, as Mr. Zepp has not responded to numerous contact attempts from myself and the veterinarian. A similar case was brought to my attention on December 23rd regarding a mixed breed female dog owned by Mr. Philip Smith. Mr. Smith called me and informed me that in March of 2014, his dog was severely injured, resulting in a broken and dislocated shoulder and leg, as well as likely internal injuries, for which he did not provide the dog with any medical care whatsoever. He went on to explain that in the last week, the dog had also been attacked by cattle that she had been chasing and was now screaming in pain constantly, which I could hear very clearly in the background. I immediately dispatched them to DCA and authorized only a pain injection to relieve this dog's immediate suffering while we investigated the circumstances further and asked for a response from an animal control officer. I also made DCA aware of my impending contact with animal control. I spoke to Officer Kuntz, welfare supervisor, and made him aware of the ongoing violation of several city, county, and state laws regarding, again, provisioning of veterinary care for Mr. Smith's dog, as well as Smith's violations regarding vaccination and licensing. Kuntz spoke to the veterinarian, whose horribly conceived plan was to allow this dog's abusers to take her home until after Christmas in her miserable state, so that the children who had watched this animal suffer this entire time, mind you, don't lose their dog before Christmas. I was speechless, and some of you know me, that's hard to do. How horribly misplaced is the empathy of this veterinarian was my first question. My shock turned to disgust quickly when the realization that this failure of the animal medical community was being backed by a welfare supervisor at our animal enforcement agency. In light of these two cases, one has to ask, is our current effort at becoming a no-kill county interfering with enforcement's ability to seize and relieve the suffering of severely injured and neglected animals? Or is it simply not the goal of this agency to enforce the welfare laws and county ordinances as they are written? These are not the only instances of direct failure to provide even the most basic enforcement. There's plenty of case evidence of not only animal control, but law enforcement's unwillingness to enforce these codes and ordinances. Numerous other welfare agencies have adopted no-kill models after several years of very heavy enforcement by cities such as San Francisco, San Diego, Austin, Texas, and New York. Enforcement of animal cruelty laws coupled with restrictions on outdoor cats, unaltered pets, and pet abandonment provide an environment where no-kill did not mean overcrowded and ineffective. Those models did not force the suffering into the field, where officers are often discouraged from doing their job because of space, bad press for even necessary euthanasia, and limited funding. I feel we need to open a dialogue about our lack of enforcement, lack of citations for clear violations, and the environment that it has created for those of us who are truly interested in seeing animal welfare in Pima County catch up with the rest of our nation. We also need to discuss animal control officers, especially supervisors, ability to override a veterinarian's opinion in the event it does not reflect the severity of a dog's need for care, considering previous neglect. It was tragic and gut-wrenching to watch so many systems fail these two and so many other animals as I work for People for Animals as a counselor to report abuse and neglect and provide assistance to animals with consideration to their circumstances of care. Both city and county have clear and strong laws prohibiting this type of neglect and cruelty of animals, and both also have a civil law providing the removal of animals from neglectful and abusive situations. Tragically, none of these laws were used by enforcement officers in these and many other cases in which an animal was allowed to suffer tremendously. I bring it to your attention to try to resolve this matter, because assistance agencies and rescues can only do so much when we are faced with the apathy of an owner and we turn to you for help. We are telling you that all of the systems in place to help this individual are inadequate in light of their lack of willingness to get their animal to care. And we need you to respond and explain to this individual that it's unlawful for them not to provide their severely wounded animal with medical care. So I hope that what I've had to say and the experiences that I had handling these two cases make a difference in how officers respond to calls in which an animal has been medically wounded. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Would Ms. Cray be willing to give us that statement to be included in the record?
Absolutely. Yeah.
You didn't get it all down?
Not quite.
Oh, come on.
All right. Thank you very much. Ms. Sullivan.
Yeah, I appreciate your taking the opportunity to speak to us, but I'm just curious. There is a state law, I believe, that requires veterinarians to report animal cruelty, so I think we have a problem with the veterinarians that are refusing to.
Hugely. Yes. I'm actually contacting the Board of Veterinary Ethics. There's an ethics advisory board for veterinary medicine. And I'm in the process of writing some letters to submit to those, but we also have a huge problem with vets that aren't willing to report obvious cruelty cases. It's frequent.
Okay, Nancy, I'll wait until you're done.
I did not meet with Mr. Zepp. I did have an extensive discussion with him, and at the time he informed me he not only had this injured dog, but its mother had the same problem and
yes.
had never received treatment.
This was also brought up to Chavez that there was another injured dog in the property.
The other thing is, when I informed him that all we could authorize was euthanasia because we did not believe in amputation, and I suggested he contact another agency that does sometimes assist with repair of tendons or bones, he informed me I had wasted his time, and that I was out of line. I didn't call him, and he really had no empathy for the animal. He just said, well, you know, his mom's fine or whatever. He had received a free visit to Southern Arizona the first day. They had bandaged it, gave him, donated medication. He was expecting somebody to pay $3,000 or more for his animal to receive treatment and not have to pay anything. This man lives in a Ryder truck and a tent in the backyard. And when I was contacted on this by Ms. Gray, I was like, you know, we referred out, but we have a standing order for euthanasia. And he basically said, I don't care what's going on with my animal, I'm not going to euthanize. And that's when Officer Chavez became involved.
I don't understand why these dogs were not impounded for neglect.
Thank you.
We read these cases all the time, and I don't understand why these dogs were not rescued.
Well,
I really don't understand where the breakdown was, but that's the whole point of your commentary. So what happened here?
Let me also finish with this.
This
case came about a week after I had already addressed this committee about a dog that was recommended to be euthanized at Valley Animal. People wanted to take the dog home so that their child could say goodbye to it. We don't know where the dog is. They gave a fake address. I had talked to some of the vets. I recently had a case this last week. 9-year-old pug attempting to have puppies and unable to do so. The vet wanted $2,000 and I offered euthanasia because they were appalled that the vet would not help them even though they had no money. The vet talked to them, they refused to euthanize their dog and they took the dog home AMA. They did have some donated medications. The vet has checked up with him and apparently the dog is doing well.
but the clinic involved, the principals of the clinic do not want to be involved in a possible lawsuit by calling in an AMA. We need to get Savmon on board. The vets have got to step up to the plate too, because there are many, many instances where they will not talk to a PAC officer, or they will, the PAC is deferring to the vet because the vet is the professional on these instances. And if the vet is saying, oh, this is okay, and then the instance of this Chewy, the vet had already had a discussion with Ms. Bray, and what was relayed to me that night is that, well, I bandaged the leg up because I assumed that it was going to another clinic where your organization was going to pay for amputation. They already know we don't do amputation.
Right.
But it got it out of the clinic and out of the vet's hands in the end. And the animal care center was told it's going to have surgery. We told the officers, no, this is not supposed to. So there's some play back and forth. Who are they going to take? The concerned citizen, the concerned rescue group, or are they going to take the person with DVM behind the name? This is something we need to come to. Savvy has got to get on board.
But what is?
And so what are we going to do about this? Because we have a responsibility to these animals. Yes, all of these animals should have been confiscated those days. But if this is something we have to address. We have to have a policy. Are we going to be able to say, ignore the veterinarian? We've got somebody over here saying, I have no money, but I have a vet saying, oh, it's okay, I can take my animal home.
But what is PAC?
What's, they're not thinking.
I mean, how are they going to, I guess I'm, exactly. Where I'm stuck is, you have a vet that is saying, it's fine. You have you or someone from the public saying it's not, and then PAC is in the middle. So what are they supposed to do?
Well, if a veterinarian sends an animal home with an AMA, they're not saying the animal is fine.
What is AMA?
Against medical advice. So if they're doing it against medical advice, the veterinarian has no control over that. Some of the clinics that we work with, the veterinarians who send their clients, their pet clients home, with an AMA will automatically call PAC or Jose and he'll check on them. And I mean, I don't know about these situations, but the ones that I supervised Mike Duffy, who is the animal cruelty investigator and co-chair of the animal cruelty task force. And Mike will call Jose and Jose jumps right on it. So I mean, I just wonder if there's something underlying in this that caused these veterinarians to release these animals without contacting PAC. I mean, the veterinarians are the ones that should be contacting PAC.
But in this case, on the second one, I thought it was the veterinarian said it's okay to take it home, and in reality, we all believe that it probably wasn't, but the vet is saying it is.
Oh, I believed you said AMA.
Okay, I had an AMA, another one AMA. The one that was Chewy, who went out with the leg, the doc, the vet said, oh, well, they're going to transport to another vet. So basically, they were releasing themselves of having to say AMA by saying, oh, well, we don't do this type of surgery, so it's got to go someplace else. I managed it. It's fine. The other situation with the injured dog, oh, we'll give it a painkiller. It'll be fine for a couple of days. Just keep it in a painkiller. It was medicated, even though they said it had to be euthanized. This is not the first time that I've been aware of a vet sending a severely injured animal home on pain meds, knowing that people did not have funds, but it got it out of the clinic. And they didn't have to say AMA because the people said, well, we'll bring it back, or we'll take it to our vet when they know there's no funding to cover it. It's a quick out. Well, they said, I'm going to take it to another vet. I gave it something to alleviate its pain, make the animal comfortable. It left, I don't have to write an AMA. So this is a situation right here because we don't know what the politics are in some of these clinics, because a lot of them do not wish to get involved with possibly having somebody say, well, you you turned me in for abusing my property. And yes, folks, animals are considered property. Not in my opinion, but that's the law in Arizona. And so they're washing their hands of the situation rather than stepping up to the plate and saying, we need to have an officer out here right now. And so this is something we need to get staff and involved in. And we need to have this, I guess, a stronger way of having enforcement come on board. Because they don't necessarily know when somebody's calling in. I could be saying, I know the situation. This is what I've been told. This is what's going on. If I'm a member of the public, they don't know who I am. But if they're calling for me, they're getting a bet who's saying, well, it's okay. I object to that bet, and personally, I would like to see that bet reprimanded. Because they took an oath to relieve the suffering, and they're putting it back out there. And so we have a quandary right now. And I really wish the staff were up here.
Does PAC have a, pardon me, but surrender in lieu of citation? You know what I mean?
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, the answer to that question is that is a technique that they can be used. But if the committee's pleasure, if PAC enforcement would like to speak to these specific cases and answer that their question, we'll have to ask the enforcement management to speak to the issue. Did you have Chavez has been up sick for a few days and sleep for him to be here. Didn't want to offer 10 pages, or should we go to 10 pages to speak to that? He was.
I
can't hear
it. Yeah, he's had trouble hearing.
Yeah, okay.
So I apologize for that.
So this is a supervisor 10 page. She's a supervisor, enforcement supervisor, Kunst Pier, and they work directly for Mr. Chavez.
Usually at any point in time, a dog owner does have that ability to relinquish ownership of their dog. Depending on the severity of the injuries that we have observed, we could still issue that citation for neglect of vet care at that time because they did not do anything to prevent suffering. The same thing without following up for vet care. You know, every time an animal goes to a vet and they are required, obviously you will look at their paperwork, you will see that they have other appointments scheduled. As with the case of Chewy, originally when he had gone, all he had heard about was that the dog had been injured. He showed an officer some form that said he was going to go back to VCA. To have them rebandage the dog, I believe in 4 days. When he went back to VCA, he was told that they weren't going to do anything because there was nothing that had been paid for. Originally, the vet had stated that the dog would need more than likely either amputation or euthanasia, at which time I believe he contacted People for Animals at that time. And then was brought over to Valley Animal Hospital and was given options at that point in time. I don't know the whole case as far as if we have followed up with him. I do understand that he had been evicted from his residence, which included a travel trailer and a U-Haul in a back of a dwelling area in a yard.
What I really meant was, does PAC ever go to this step of saying, if you surrender this dog, we will not cite you for lack of care or for no license on this lack of care? Because if you can't afford medical care, you may not even afford a license.
Well, the issue for the license is moot at that point.
Well, I'm just thinking,
if they're surrendering the animal
to
us, but they always have that right to surrender an animal, and depending on the severity of the injuries, is whether we would
we can bring in a dog, if we bring in a dog in, or an animal, and our veterinarian looks at that animal and says, this is, you know, because the officers in the field are not vets.
Right,
you know, so our capability of answering that and looking at an animal, you know, if it's something outright obvious, compound fracture that was never, and it's now infected, and the dog basically is going to either have the leg amputated or be euthanized, we would issue citations right then, or go by what our veterinarian, after she examines that animal, and lets us know. And then we'll go back and issue.
On this one particular case with Chewy, you already were aware the People for Animals had been involved. That means the person does not have any means as a general way of paying that bill. When somebody has been investigated, do you say, how are you paying for the vet care? Because at that point, he had already been denied vet care from any further additional assistance from us, another agency had turned him down, and nobody checked to see if this person had the financial means to follow up at the vet. The man had no intention of going back if he had to pay a vet bill at VC, and he was aware nobody was going to pay his vet bill. And this is a matter of concern for me, because when somebody has a welfare check and they say, well, I'm supposed to go back to the vet on this day, somebody should be saying, how did you pay for the last call, and do you have the means to provide vet care? Because if they don't have the financial means to take care of the animal at that time, at the time of service, chances are they're not going to have the financial means to take care of that animal at a clinic. And I'll tell you right now, the vets generally do not provide vet care for free. It might be the when somebody adopts an animal from PAC, the visit just includes basically weighing the animal, taking their temperature, listening to the heart and lungs, and they'll have a physical exam, but no diagnostics are done. The vets do not give free immunizations, they do not do sutures, they don't even take a bandage off unless you are going to pay for that. And so if somebody, there's already a complaint filed about failure to provide vet care, and they don't have the financial means, why somebody can say, yeah, I'm supposed to take the dog back in 4 days to this vet, the next question should be, well, you have the financial means, how do you plan to pay for that? Because if they say, well, I don't have any, right then that animal should have said, okay, this animal is not in an appropriate place, and that animal should have been confiscated.
In our procedures, we don't question people about their financial stability. The animal had received the initial vet care. The paperwork from the veterinarian specifically stated they had a follow-up visit later that week, and we did follow up to make sure that he did show up. I believe he showed up a day late. I believe he got the dog there. I don't know if it was on his bicycle or something, to the vet, at which time that's when we realized that the vet was, I guess he called Jessica, because there was no further monetary value as far as put down on his dog for to have the leg rewrapped.
And he was told that at the time.
But it wasn't put, like I say, it's not on our paperwork from the vet. And that's what we go by, is what the vet said. And then we were following up with that vet to make sure that he followed up at that point. And then it wound up going to Valley Animal Hospital after that. And I believe Jessica did, in fact, pick him up and take him there. And I don't know if it had been followed up. I did not. I do know that the dog did have surgery. There was one follow-up from, I believe it was Investigator Klein. And then something that she got a message, a voicemail, that he had been evicted.
And isn't it against state and county law to abuse animals and not to take care of animals?
Mm-hmm.
So there's the leg to stand on to have taken that dog out of this man's ownership by not taking care of this animal, abusing the animal.
Well, originally he did get that care, even though it was through someone else as a third party paying for it.
No, it was her.
He did not. He went
went into Southern Arizona after the dog injured his leg, said, I have no money. They cleaned the wound and put a bandage on it and told him he had to get vet care.
Ms. Gray.
There's some minor deviation, in fact, from how these two things match up against each other. I, first of all, let Officer Chavez know that the man had no means to get vet care because his only means was people for animals. And all we were offering was euthanasia, which he refused to avail himself and the dog too. So everyone from square one, from the first call to animal control regarding this case, knew that there were no means to treat the animal's injuries because only euthanasia was being offered by our program, and Mr. Zupp had no other means and would not avail the dog to the euthanasia being offered. And at no time did we not offer euthanasia. Even when he went to BCA and found out that there was no care to rewrap or continue with care of the leg of any kind, he had at that exact moment the opportunity to euthanize his pet and again refused to do so.
This dog was in pain from a previous injury, isn't that correct? Many months ago?
No, the second case involving Mr. Philip Smith is the case in which the dog had been previously injured. However, it is worth noting that the injury to Chewy occurred right around November 11th, and the veterinarian at Savs said that he should immediately euthanize the pet or obtain further veterinary care within 3 days, and it was a month until he contacted me again. And Chewy's leg was decomposing in that bandage when I picked him up and took him to BCA. You'd have to be real nose deaf to not notice there was a problem with that.
So of course, animal care should have impounded that animal. When Jessica reported, of course there should be. Animal had already been suffering for a long, long time. Didn't need to have a veterinarian say they could put a bandage on.
A lot of times we contact the veterinary facility, and we get the veterinary notes and whatever the veterinarian has put down. I don't know if the history was there that the dog had first been presented in November and then presented again. And if it said that there was something such as necrotic tissue with the leg itself, but there was a follow-up that was put on there that he was to follow back and bring the dog back to them within the 4 day time or week time to change the bandage, and that's what our officer went by, is what the veterinarian did.
We did provide both sets of medical records from Southern Arizona at the initial incident, as well as the first set of veterinary records from DCA at the time of my report to Officer Chavez.
Okay, and Investigator Klein had gone on this call, and that was her decision and determination as far as him doing the follow-up vet care on it at that time.
Ms. Shorey?
Well, we never did do the follow-up vet care. And so one of the biggest problems here is that Pima Animal Care should act for the animal when receiving credible reports about the necessity for acting, even if we are contradicted by a veterinarian. And I don't know where you are getting at that veterinarian, that you don't want to contradict a veterinarian. Veterinarians are frequently wrong, as they were in these cases. And why is it that you, if it has something to do with winning a case in court, we could always get another veterinarian to testify on behalf of the animal.
Is that a question to Mr. James or a commentary?
No, that was a commentary. We could always get another veterinarian to testify on behalf of the animal. But my question is, why do you not want to take any action that would contradict anything that any veterinarian says?
Ms. Shorey, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, we try not to do anything on an absolute. We don't ever, not necessarily that we would never do that, but we do follow general kennel procedures, and based upon experience, you yourself have said we have won almost all of our cases.
Yes.
Because we have these types of procedures, where there's some question about if there's not, if there's vet care there, regardless of how egregious we may think it, citing that person and impounding the animal and going through all that process, just have a judge say, no, it requires him to get vet care, he had vet care, as long as that vet said, you got to be careful about that. So we're balanced, that is a balancing act, and if you're careful about that, there's many other variables that officers are faced with. So that's generally what we go through, a series of questions and answers as we review these cases, and the officers and supervisors take a look at the history, and I hear you loud and clear. There was evidence that between November 11th and whatever day next was, that the animal may have been suffering. By the time we were involved, it was under vet care, and our officer went out there and looked at Chewy, and did not appear to be suffering. It was ugly. That limb was ugly, but it was not suffering. We have to err on the side of suffering, not on the side of ugly, and the appearance of it. And I know that there's differences of opinion in these situations. We will take this discussion, this council, this advice on. We may want to revisit when we want to and how we put, where we draw the line. Once a veterinarian has gotten involved, and what we do with that.
I have a question. Actually, two. Would Pat, knowing that, I don't know the exact date, so I'll just arbitrarily put a date. On November 1st, we knew the dog was actually injured, severely injured, and had suffered up until the point where the Pat got involved, or called into. So let's say that we know that the dog should have been, that person should have taken care of that dog immediately, but chose not to do that for a period of weeks or months or whatever. Then Pat was involved, and then they did. Even if we say he was getting medical care, which we know he wasn't getting medical care, he was just there. The fact remains that the dog suffered from that point up until they finally went down to medical care. Would those be the grounds needed for Pat to be able to say, look, you might be getting medical care now, but you left that dog suffering from the time of injury all the way up until now, where you're now here, and that by itself, and in and of itself, means that you're forfeiting this animal. Does that make sense?
It does, Chair. Do you want to answer that first?
Yeah, sure. I'll
follow up. Chair, member of the committee, and Debbie, step in any time with your thoughts on this. But knowing that we must balance whatever the veterinarian record says against taking that action. The veterinarians say you need to come back in 3 days, and then we find out later on that it wasn't suffering. It's like the case that Ms. Emptage talked about earlier. This bad animal's in bad shape, but a few days later, it was okay. We're not in this position to say, well, that the veterinarian said come back and check it, but since we don't have definitive information that it truly was suffering, even though history says the averages are that type of injury would equal X. I'm not saying I agree with this, but from a position of enforcing a law and being successful, we do have some balances to look at, and again, we'll take a look at that line where you
do. Well, that's a subjective determination. I mean, we all do that, and we all have to explain why.
Yes.
I would feel as a person that this dog was suffering. So
yes.
Even if I had to testify, if I saw a dog and his leg was, all his arteries were torn off, I could probably be, without being a vet,
yes,
be able to say that dog was suffering without being a doctor or a vet. I mean, now that's right, but I know that much. The second question though, that I have is more to you all. Do you have contracts with these two facilities that are dealing with these dogs? And the reason I ask that is, all of us have different lives in the past, and some of us had to contract with doctors and stuff for different things before we were. And if they didn't do what we asked, they didn't get our money. Not that we asked them to bend the rules or anything like that, but we did expect them to do certain things. And I'm asking you, are you paying these different, or these two different facilities that have vets, are getting them business still? It's the same facility for both. Worse yet, are you still paying that facility?
No, we have broken off with the DCA, except for euthanasias. Because of the both cases, both these cases in which veterinarians acted terrible with the DCA.
Any other commentaries or questions on this issue?
I have a question. What do you recommend?
At this point in time with Chewy, we will follow up on him if he has not gotten vet care. At this point in time, we know that that dog is in danger. He has not followed what the veterinarian has stated. We can issue citations. We can pick up the dog and hold it for bond if he does not relinquish ownership.
Now, was he cited for failure to provide a current vaccination license on the mother dog, who actually had a very similar injury degree to this that went untreated for years? He did have another dog that was not vaccinated and was not licensed. And when the officer went out to check the premise, that dog should have been there and he should have received a citation for that.
I'm trying to remember her verbiage in her activity report. If there was another dog there, I know there were other dogs, there's a front house also. But I do know, I don't remember exactly what had happened.
Okay, and I'm going to put you in, I'm going to play, you're the counselor. And you get a call, 10 o'clock at night. I'm calling because I've been told that you help pay vet bills. I have no money. My dog just broke its leg. What am I supposed to do? What would you tell that person?
In what position? The position that I am in?
You are the person they're calling to pay the vet bill. I'm telling you, I'm calling you because I have an injured animal, or I have a sick animal, and I have no money, and I'll go one further.
I'm not sure where I'm going.
No, I want to know, okay, if somebody says, I want to know what you want me to tell them or what information I need to gather, because if that person says, oh, well, I can't pay for it, what do you want me to do? And say, well, okay, I'll send it down to the vet and have it checked out, and I'm going to address it, whatever, but it's 10 o'clock at night. Am I then supposed to call Pat and say, I have somebody who's called and have a dog with a broken leg, they're calling for vet care, they have no money. So am I supposed to call and say, I need you guys to go out so they can build a case, so if I get down there and the vet says it's $3,000 to have this leg repaired, and we say we can't do this, and people say, well, I'm taking my dog and I'm leaving, what do you want me to do? Do I have to? But they've been to the vet and had vet care. The vet, so.
Yeah, but that wasn't vet. If it's not vet care, in other words, if they took the dog home still with that same exact injury, it didn't get wrapped, it wasn't stabilized, we would follow up immediately. It would be an emergency call for us within our given hours. We would respond and hopefully make contact with the dog owner. If not, if the dog was in the backyard, no one was home, and we see the dog in that state of being injured and in distress, we would have the authority to remove the dog, leave a notice of impound, bring the dog to either a veterinarian, depending on the time of day, or bring it to our facility and let our vet assess what's going on with the particular dog. Eventually, meet with the owners if they call to find out the dog's been impounded. And at that point in time, based upon our veterinarian's assessment of that animal, they would be given that opportunity to relinquish ownership of the animal.
I have a suggestion. First of all, you're not going to resolve this right here. So since it is an issue, and it's an issue with enforcement, and I would imagine that there are other organizations that pay, right?
One other one.
Can we set up a meeting between that organization and, let's say, Mr. Chavez, where you can discuss what type of circumstances they would come out, what they wouldn't, so everybody's on the same page.
Okay.
what you need from us.
What they need, what Mr. Chavez's department needs from people like yourself.
I've got a cruelty investigator that's sitting
over here. Would you be amenable to that?
I certainly will. She takes pictures.
Mr. Jane, would the agency be aware of amenable to do that?
I want to confirm with the acting COO, Dr.
I can't hear you. I have to speak up. I'm suffering from hearing loss.
So,
so you'd have to speak up. I'm not sure.
That's right. So, yes, Mr. Newman, Chairman Newman, and members of the advisory committee, we'd be happy to have that conversation. As Kim has very rightfully sort of pointed out, that is a complex issue in our legal system. Even companion animals constitute property, and there are some legal issues involved. But I think continuing to have this conversation with you is a good thing to do.
What is the purpose of the meeting that you're suggesting?
So the purpose of the meeting that I'm suggesting, so that there's a dialogue between the people that are handling these issues and the agency and the department within the agency that is handling these issues. So right now, I'm seeing and hearing two different sides, and everybody has questions on it as well, but the primary people that need to understand it are you. It's you, and Ms. Gray, and any other agency that is paying for things like that. So the dog is taken to a vet, and the vet says, well, it's okay or not okay. What responsibility does PAC have or willing to give when it says, well, we can see that, you know, this dog is not good?
And I do have
so
one.
That's the dialogue that you all need to have.
And I have one question, and maybe the committee members or whatever, or Mr. James can answer this question. Sometimes it's perceived even that we're not the client, even though we're paying the bill, because we don't own the animal. Honestly, we are the client, we're the one paying the bill, and we have a little release saying that they have to sign that they are granting permission to people for animals to release information. And usually, if need be, we just say, get all the vet records together, fax them over to PAC, if we're in a position where we call right away. But how would you determine who has the right to, because it is property, we're the client paying the bill. Do we have the right to make this complaint? Or is it separate because we don't, is this something that we're talking touchy grounds here? Because that might be an issue for the attorneys before we meet.
Ms. Empey, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, a payer source is not the client in any medical situation. However, in this situation, a complaint from a citizen about a concern, and I think it was described very well before the point of the first call, that you're getting concerned about that person has to take care of their animal, that's the time to call back, and that's for that discussion. And as far as releasing information to the animal care center, animal care center talks to vets, and they can get the information they need subject to an investigation. And what information you may or may not get is purely between you and your client. We will not and cannot get between them.
Thank you.
Okay, so with that said, you'll make an appointment. And I guess it could be reported out later, just out of curiosity. I'd sure like to know what actually occurred. All right, so the next issue, and I'm combining these two issues. Thank you, Ms. Gray.
We're going to be more succinct.
Okay, thank you.
We have a receipt here.
Thank you, Ms. Gray.
There are two issues, the county administration in response to the committee's request to add additional field officers and shelter staff. With the new agenda item that I requested be put on the agenda, and that is a jurisdiction, IGA discussion, and county obligation for animal care services inside cities and towns. Now, I was wondering if I could ask the deputy county administrator to explain what that is and what is actually happening with that particular issue. Because I think it's going to raise, I heard something about it earlier this week, and it's going to raise some eyebrows.
Good evening, I'm Jan Lesher, and thank you very much for being here. Jack and Francisco and I met earlier this week and chatted about a variety of issues, and I want to take an opportunity to talk a little bit about what's going on with the other jurisdictions and some of the other meetings we're having. So forgive me for taking a while, but some of the explanation of this. So I think you all know, we provide services, we're legally mandated to provide services in unincorporated Pima County. In order for us to step into any of the jurisdictions within the incorporated community, Tucson, South of the Sonoma Valley, et cetera, we have to have an intergovernmental agreement with each of those entities. And as you also know, over the last few years, the amount that we have been spending on animal care has increased. We've been making very good progress. As I said tonight, we're not anywhere near where we need to be, but we're a whole lot better than we were, and we're continuing to move in that direction. And I'll own the fact that in the last couple of years, we did, in 1 year, I think it was 2 years ago, when we came with about $1.2 million that was increased as a supplemental halfway through the year. Those kinds of issues then hit the jurisdictions during their budget cycle, and it's not the way they like to hear those numbers, and we have agreed it's not the way they should be hearing those numbers. So we've been chatting with them about new ways in which we can communicate to the jurisdictions to make sure we get those budgets in. To that end, there have been concerns about the amount we spend and how we spend it at PAC, and so we convened, I'm going to say November, not Francisco, a couple months ago, the city managers, the town managers, each of the incorporated jurisdictions, and we meet with them to talk about the PAC budget and what the money is going to be like, because through those IGAs, then they pay the county for the payment for those services we're providing in the incorporated areas, just to give you an idea of round numbers, yeah, not exact, but just sort of ballpark. The budget of PAC is about $6 million. Through the IGA of the city of Tucson, they reimburse the county about $3 million. Again, roughly, it's not exactly, but about half of that. We began to meet with the jurisdictions to talk about those intergovernmental agreements. And you see, we established, I would say, two guiding principles as we went into the conversations. One being where we can't take away from the Board of Supervisors any real, the final legal end of the day authority that I can't, the jurisdictions, for example, wanted to become the body that would make all decisions about animal care's budget and the operation of animal care. So can't do that, it legally lies with the Board of Supervisors, so I can't change that. The second thing is we are not going to step back from the quality of care and the services we're providing. It's taken us a long time to get to this point, we can't do that. That being said, and as you mentioned, Jack, as we begin to look at conversations coming from this body about the increase, the concern about increased staff, the jurisdictions believe we're spending too much on that. And for purpose of this conversation, I'm going to paint with a pretty broad brush, and that it's not, we sit with all of the entities, and some, if you ask them tomorrow, may have a different opinion about some issues. But I'll be candid with the questions from the jurisdictions. Why do we even have cats? We're not legally mandated to have cats. Wouldn't it be cheaper and better if we just stopped taking care of cats? We were asked if they, one of the communities wanted us to establish a policy that we would never keep an animal longer than 3 days. Obviously not consistent with any goals that we have towards moving towards a no-kill environment, or simply not killing all animals in 3 days. We have some challenges going on, again, wanting to keep moving the needle in the quality of care. Also, to be quite candid, what we've explained to the jurisdictions, any elected body represents the people they serve. Pima County is the only entity of the ones of any of the jurisdictions that actually has responsibility for animals, which means the Board of Supervisors hears from all of you and hears from people who care about animals all the time. The other jurisdictions don't hear from people with animals because there's no reason to call necessarily, unless it's for a community cat grant or something. You don't call Oro Valley or Cerrito with a concern about an animal necessarily. So they're elected officials and their cities don't see that there is a need in the community. The interim city manager has said it's a very difficult budget time. We hate to say it, they tell us, but we have to make very, very difficult decisions, and we simply have to put people above pets, and we're going to have to make some tough decisions about how we spend our money. It has gotten to the point of discussions about whether or not we will actually continue intergovernmental agreements with the other jurisdictions, primarily the city of Tucson is one in question. And I'll, you know, I'll tell you the truth, it becomes, it's a real pickle for us. If we are going to have it, if somebody comes in and says, we don't have an IGA, maybe the county says, figure out somebody else to provide your services, knowing there really isn't. But we all know at the end of the day, if we don't have an IGA tomorrow, we're still going to get those animals at PAC, I believe. You know, I don't think that, or the other side of the coin is I've asked staff to start looking at what is the funding going to be? What's the financing going to be? Are we going to have a sign at PAC that says, if you live in any of these jurisdictions, leave us your animal? If you live in the city of Tucson or maybe Sarita, it costs you $100 for different services. It's going to be extraordinarily problematic for us to keep as a county a policy by which we're dealing with the animals in the same way, and that we're continuing, I think, to move the needle forward so that the quality of care issues that you all have been talking about, we talk about, can continue to get better. So I mentioned to Jack when Francisco and Jack and I were meeting these concerns, because what we're balancing is working with PACAC and other groups who come to us wanting us to continue to provide the new funds, additional funds, more money for PAC, and I'm dealing with the jurisdictions who are saying, where are you going to cut the budget at PAC? And so that's what I'm looking at, and we wanted to share with Jack and with all of you what we're facing is the realities. Everybody's having tough budget times. The city, as you know, is looking at last numbers I heard might be 100 million. I mean, just horrible decisions that they're being faced with, and this is what they're talking about. So when we chatted, I said maybe one of the things we want to start talking about with this group is how do we get the community engaged in letting all of jurisdictions understand how important animals are. And you've all been there. We sit here tonight, we hear from people who are passionate and care about animals, so we know it matters. I've had representatives of some of the large jurisdictions tell me we do not have feral cats in Pima County. They're just not, and bless their heart, I mean, we all are busy, you can fill 24 hours a day, you hear from people who call you with their concerns. We just don't call those jurisdictions. They don't hear about the need, and their elected officials don't hear about it, and that represents the policies that they make in cutting their budgets. What we've been looking at doing, how do we share information between the two groups? PACAC meets once a month, the jurisdictions now meet once a month. As I explained to them when they come in and said, we need to cut the budget, I said, we'd like to bring to you the proposal from PACAC to increase some of the staff in key positions, and let you understand, what's happening, on that side of the coin. So I just wanted to, I'm happy to answer any questions and share any additional information that I can, just to give you the lay of the land of the realities of this. Again, you all have done such an extraordinary job. We have so many wonderful volunteers, rescue groups, people involved with animals in our community who have let us all hear loud and clear, not only at PAC every single day, you have staff hearing it, what we demand for our animals in Pima County and how much we want to do for them. I'm probably never going to be able to tell you we're doing it, but we're really working hard to do it better every single day. We have elected officials who hear you, you've seen it with the community cat grant and the amending the codes and the things we had to do with all of you to make sure we had that right. And we're really trying to educate the other jurisdictions. And I'll just tell you that there is a piece of this that staff owns. I mentioned at the beginning, we had done it as well. Nobody likes surprises. Nobody wants to get halfway through the year and be handed a bill for $300,000. Wasn't fair, wasn't a way to do it. We're not going to do that again. I know that's part of our pledge as well. But we really need to start working with those jurisdictions. So I appreciate Jack having the opportunity to chat with you all tonight and just give you a little Reader's Digest version of what we're doing. If I may, Francisco, is there anything else that is that okay?
I did want to ask you something. At that meeting, I had recommended and asked if we couldn't meet with that other committee, letting them know where we're coming from, and at least explaining what we're doing and where we're coming from. And then, of course, that can expand a lot of things along the lines of, by the way, your constituents are the same as we've been dealing with in Pima County. And isn't Tucson about almost half? I was looking at the way more than half the dogs are coming, but as far as the money, they're, from what I'm seeing, is they, in the 2014-15 budget, would be almost, actually just a little bit higher than the county itself.
Than the incorporated, yeah.
Yes. Incorporated.
Well, and so in pieces of that, and one of the things that we've asked the jurisdictions to talk amongst them between themselves is how do we allocate those costs? Because that's something, you know, we want to hear. We look at it sometimes. Do we do it by the number of animals they bring in? Do we do it by the number of days that animals are in our facility? Do we do it by population? I don't know. But that's a good discussion, I think, for them to determine amongst them between themselves. As long as it adds up to 100, it's fine for us, you know, which way they're going to go. We're looking now, as Karen and all the staff at PAC have done such an extraordinary job in getting to actually raise additional charitable dollars into PAC. We're looking at how we allocate those back to the jurisdictions again from whence they came, understanding we've been very successful bringing in money from outside of the Pima County, so everybody wants credit for that. But there's a lot of ways we can look at how those animals are coming in and how we're allocating it. But to the first part of your question, I think it's a terrific idea for us to get all of the city managers in the jurisdictions, who usually come as the city manager or if they can, the assistant city managers, and then the financial officers. So you got, you know, they're here to balance a budget, you know. God bless them. So it'll be good to, I think, get some conversations going to reach for you.
I was thinking as you were talking that, and these are the money people, but they're not necessarily elected. And so, I mean, even if we meet with them, it's all about the money. Then they're not all that concerned about being elected. Mm-hmm. Unlike, as volunteers, from my perspective, you know, we're planning on mobilizing as many volunteers as we can and actually attending those city council meetings and doing it that way, in a sense. They're the ones that are being elected. And a lot of the people that are volunteers are living in those municipalities. Some are in incorporated areas, but for the most part, they're in those areas and to exert that type of pressure. But, you know, as we meet with them, we could be letting them know the same thing. So much for turning off our phone. But
we always remember once we're
meeting. Yeah. But anyway, we're meeting with the city manager, I guess the final one trying to get across is the city manager and the finance manager aren't elected, so they might not be as receptive to us saying, you know, it's not just, I mean, you have a lot of people that are interested in this versus meeting with the city council. But we can do that too, right?
Well, whatever you want to be, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. But as Francisco and I aren't elected either, but right. We are here as a voice for our bosses who are.
Yeah.
So I think there is a sensitivity and understanding of the positions from which they come.
Okay.
But I mean, two ways to.
Or both ways.
Can't say skinny.
Yeah, no.
To fix the problem.
Yeah.
That's what I was going to suggest. Maybe as the advisory committee, we should go start sitting in on the city council meetings and let them know that we're not just here as advisors, we're here to show them that we have a say in this too, and show them that we all mean it. It's not just we're not here once a month.
In fact, I think that's important. Even I think at some point, if the organization wanted to look at a letter from PAC, from PAC Act to each of the elected officials for the five jurisdictions, Green Valley is not incorporated, but the five jurisdictions can be letters, willingness to meet, communicate. Again, I think with the city of Tucson, it was a really great experience for us, and I know many of you were involved. Sort of our first opportunity again to deal with members of the city council about animal issues because it just really hadn't been on our radar screen before. You know, I think that before we think they're not paying attention, it's just not been their issue, so let us help educate them.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, I was just curious because when we were talking about the putting some kind of law through the city about puppy mill dogs, our group went and individually met with each individual member of the city council. Would that be something that this committee would be allowed to do?
Absolutely. I mean, you're individual. Well, there's a difference between education and advocacy, you know, and I think at this point, you're simply educating. You know, you're advocating. There's a way, you went in and talked about puppy mills, that's education. Same way 501c3s can do some, as you know, from the Humane Society, there's a certain amount of education, even a little bit of advocacy you can do, but I think as long as we're still at the point of, I think educating people about, and we're glad to get you all the information we shared with the jurisdictions as well. But just so you know, what are we spending? How are we spending it? You know, how are we moving towards that? Towards the goal? And I think what we need to figure out is how do we get our heads around it. What would happen in the community now if we began to step backwards? And that's my great fear, that part of what we've talked about with the jurisdictions is not only the impact of this, but quite frankly, one of the reasons that we've moved from looking at 2000, I looked at 5 years of data. In 2009, we raised in an entire year $170,000 in charitable donations. In the month of December, we raised $110,000. So it's extraordinary the way we're moving. But a lot of that money is coming in from organizations around the country who are supporting the change in a mission and a direction of the organization. So we've got to figure that out too. The jurisdictions can are allocated, have to pay less because what comes off the top is the charitable money that comes in. So we're helping them save money by bringing in more money that we may lose if they're pushing us in any way to policies that are not consistent with the direction we're moving at PAC.
Any other questions?
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Awesome. I heard that earlier, and I'm hearing it now. Having any type of situation where we're going to turn away dogs or have to charge and unravel everything that we've accomplished, PAC, us, the community, thus far. And so that's why I wanted this to be first and foremost on it, because we can be talking about a lot of things, but if this happens, then that would take care of all the other things we're talking about. We just go down the drain. So my own suggestion would be to actually meet like you did with the elected officials, where we make appointments to meet with them and tell them what we're up to, what we're doing. And I'm right now composing a letter to volunteers, and I requested information, and I was given information as to how I can give information concisely to volunteers to go to those meetings and things like that. But we would be doing our part, volunteers and other people could be doing their part.
I think that there's a really huge need for education. If somebody sat at a meeting with you folks and said that, why are we holding an animal more than 3 days? Why are we holding an animal more than 4 days? There are podunk communities in this country that only hold animals for 2 or 3 days because they don't have the money to feed them. But we are not a community that is in that situation. And we have to educate our city council members and let them know that we're not going to hold an animal for 3 days. We're going to hold it as long as we need to hold it till we can put it into a home. And they have to come on, they have to ride that bus with us. I mean, we just need to make that happen.
That, of course, and that would be their decision if they want to. I mean, rather than say, we're going to go down this path, or whatever, then they can take back whatever they want to take from when we say, we're going down this path, we're not turning back. It's when they get enough pushback from us and from the people, their constituents, that are saying, no, we want this to continue. I mean, we voted for a new shelter. This would be a perfect time to be pushing this issue, considering there's been so much press on the bond and all sorts of things that would be in our favor as far as elevating this to a level where it would not look good for them to be putting down cats and dogs after 3 days. When they're spending money on a lot of other things, and a lot of people in their community is saying, gosh, we spent $250 million on something else that I'm never using. And so that's why I wanted us to hear it directly. So what do you think? Of course, it actually would be
letters, and I think we should start as a group, if we can, attend the meetings.
I agree.
And let them know who we are.
I agree. Well, do they have a call to the audience like the Pima County does, where you go into the beginning and fill
out? Why don't we get a package together for you with where the council, who the council is, who's on them, where they're from, when they meet, any kind of how to contact them through their clerk of the board, or their clerk of whatever the council is, and get you a little roadmap of who they are and where they are and how they meet. They all have called the audiences. Some are at the beginning, some at the end, some are both. we'll get it all out to you.
So would everybody be okay with, when we get that information, that we would put out an agenda, because I can't be contacting you and saying this stuff. That we put that out, at least have, was it four or five?
Five, Chairman.
Five people, at least we need, so that we can,
four.
Four. At least four, so that we can discuss that, and then it can be passed up to everybody, at least four. And so it'd be like an emergency type of meeting, and then we can plan from that point once we get that information. Okay?
I agree.
Okay. All right, we'll do that. Okay. With that, we'll move on now. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
The animal welfare and dangerous animal cases for the month of December and recent holds snapshot. Any discussion on that?
Yes, I have just a few.
What happened on that?
Well, there's the, on the summary, that was number three. The animal is not redeemed and is euthanized due to its aggression. And number four, in question number three.
Yeah. This woman, there was, seems to be some kind of a discrepancy about who was supposed to take care of the dog or whatever. In this case, I'm assuming she's going to court. Can we then recommend that this person not be allowed to have dogs again? She obviously does not, this is something on behalf of the Animal Welfare Coalition that I would like to put forward a recommendation to the court that this person be banned from owning animals because she's clueless. And we're just gonna, if she gets just a fine, another animal could very well be put in this position. And so I would like to have this request made to the court as well, that this woman does not deserve to have animals. So I don't know if the committee agrees with that, but that's my favorite statement on these things. And you know, this is coming up again.
Can I make a motion
that we recommend that there's a recommendation from the advisory committee that the court put a judgment, part of the judgment, that this person not be allowed to have animals.
Second. All in favor?
Number five. This owner had his animals on tie-outs. Now it says that the situation's been rectified, but it also said that this person gave reason to believe that he placed the dogs back on the tie-outs. So who's to say that just to be contrary, suggest there's a temporary fix, and I'm not going to deal with this. These animals could very well be back on tie-outs. And yeah, it's for your protection. Yes, he was aggressive towards the animal care officer. It's highly possible that this was a husky mix or is back on a tie-out. Just, you know, they may have done a temporary fix. Has anybody checked on it again?
Ms. Empties, Mr. Chair, absolutely. On the 6th of January, we're back and confirmed that the animals were not using, being placed on tie-out.
Thank you.
And the WC4. This dog was on a tie-out, panel of a tie-out around a tree without access to water or shelter. He was given citations for neglect, tie-out, neglect no water, and neglect no shelter. And why it's not explained here at all, why was this owner allowed to be, or no, number four, why was this animal not even in county? Had no water, shelter, on a tie-out. Well, and it's not explained here, why was this animal not impounded?
Ms. Shereen, Mr. Chair, members of the committee, we can certainly go back and revisit the case file and talk to the officer and get their notes as to why they made the judgment call to leave this pet for this particular one.
This is seven. This is seven.
Okay, go over the one.
Okay, on number six, the dogs on a tie-out, when they went back to check, first of all, he said that the dog should be gone by the 1st of December. We went back, the dog was on a tie-out, and he refused to sign citations. Where's the dog now?
Good question. Mr. Chair, members of the committee, yes, ma'am. I'm not being sort of facetious, it's, maybe I should have left that at her door before.
He's gone, it's gone, but. I mean, this is a, another one I'd like to see, he can't have animals.
Again, Supervisor Tent is here taking notes on these cases, so she is also here in your council and your advice on these cases.
I mean, this, he doesn't value the companion animal here, it's obvious, and, thank you. Can I pull another one?
Sure.
Number ten?
Yes.
Okay. This is an absolutely horrible case. And if I can have a lifetime ban put on this person, I would. It's. I just don't even know where to begin. And I'm seeing some pretty horrendous things. It's just, people just don't seem to care. And this is another one. I don't think they're ever going to learn. This is just so horrendous. And so I would, again, like to make a recommendation that this person actually be banned from having animals. I'd love to see family and animal charges put up against him for the state of Brownie. You know, well, oh yeah, he got better the other time. I'm sorry. You know, I'd like to see him prosecuted for felony cruelty.
Is that a motion?
Well, I don't think that. I mean, I would really like to have somebody. I mean, I'd like to see the book thrown at this person. As much that could be done, because this is just like it makes me sick to look at this case. And I don't quite know how to pose this because it's just you know, and I'm sorry, it's the holidays too. You know, this is cruelty man and everything else, and this is obviously not cutting it. So
well, these are all sick.
Sick. Yeah.
So it's not like.
So I again.
So the if you were out anybody, would anybody another way of wording that other than you know decapitation or something? That we can word this to the county attorney's office. You know, we looked at this particular case and see that it is of such severity that maybe they could take some extra time looking at what type of charges they would be posing against this individual.
The severity of the charges. Mm-hmm.
Yes, officer.
Sometimes it's hard to get, you know, a felony charge on these. We have gone, he has been put on the do not adopt list immediately. Owner's been on a do not adopt list. The dog was sent out for necropsy, which was Brownie. All the other dogs were turned over to us. We had no history at this address prior to showing up that day. And the conditions that the dogs were in was not acceptable. Charges were issued and they're pending at this time. We have them on our own PAC do not adopt list and are pushing forward that he at least get the minimum used by citations being issued in the fines, that he at least, the longest they can do is 3 years of no animal ownership. And hopefully that in fact does work.
Thank you.
Okay, so I'm going to put my motion out there that we put forward a recommendation that the county attorney and the judge be made aware of our position on this case, that whatever fines and ban be maximum against this assessment should be the maximum punitive damages that against this individual. And hopefully
favor?
You have a discussion?
Yes.
Oh, right.
I didn't know that, that was some favor.
I've finished, at least up to a point, an ordinance that I've been working on for quite a long time. And I addressed that very point. Would you like to hear what I put in this proposal?
Please.
This comes under cruelty and neglect of animals. Maybe I should read a little bit about penalties. A violation of any provision, this is already in the law, of this section is punishable by a fine of not less than $100 nor more than $2,500. 6 months in jail, 3 years probation, or any combination thereof. No judge may grant probation in lieu of or otherwise suspend the imposition of the minimum fine prescribed herein. And this is the rest of it is the part that I'm proposing. If the perpetrator was the owner of the animal, of the animals which are the subject of this action, the justice of the peace may order that the animals be forfeited to the Pima Animal Care Center. In addition, the justice of the peace may order that the perpetrator, whether owner or otherwise, shall not be permitted to own, harbor, or have custody, control, or charge of any animal for a period of up to 5 years or longer or ever.
Okay, let's start again. Okay, so where was it?
And then the rest of it is still in the law. This shall not be construed to affect in any way the imposition of any mandatory minimum penalties provided herein. So I'd like to make the motion that this group support
So all in favor?
What was the motion?
Angie's motion?
My motion.
Thank you.
That the committee support that this individual will receive the maximum punitive damages or punitive action that can be allotted to them. Okay. All in favor? All opposed? Okay. So moved. You said you had a motion before we move on to this?
Yeah. What about Mr. James?
Mr. Reed, Mr. Chair, I believe this is one thing that we do need to agenda item before we take action on such
all this
on ordinance.
Thank you.
But it's not on the agenda somewhere or related so we can discuss related.
Let's just have, I'm sorry. Mr. Chair, Mr. Chair, I do not believe that they would be construed as that.
Okay.
But we can have it on, you can request it, it will be on the next moving to our next
special meeting.
Well, it can be brought up after the special meeting that we're planning on having on the other issue if it's done 24 hours before. But what we're talking about on the issue of how to approach the city, basically the city of Tucson, I guess we can discuss it then. If that quorum is desired.
I thought we were not going to have a quorum. The purpose was not to have a quorum?
No, the purpose is to. Is to, so that we can talk about, when I get the information from Ms. Lesher, that I'm able to, then we can talk about it openly, because it would have already been a quorum and it's on it be a 24-hour notice, we can read, and anybody can see it.
May I make a motion that we have a special meeting to address the Ms. Lesher's topics and this ordinance before the next regularly scheduled meeting of this committee to just specifically address those two topics.
I thought we were going to do that, but do we have a second on that motion? We have a second. All in favor of having an emergency meeting on those two issues? Four, five, all, okay, it's unanimous. Okay. The next, Bill.
Still on the welfare cases. I wonder if I could get the court dates on some of these cases. WC2, WC4, and WC5. 2, 3, 4, 5, and 10.
2, 3, 4, 5.
As far as you know, have any of them taken place already?
I would have to take a look at that. Usually 11 days after each case, so one of them, I definitely need to confirm.
Okay, any others? No? Okay, we'll move to dangerous dogs. Any discussion on that? Okay.
We're losing our group a little bit, but would it be possible to rearrange our agenda? Just maybe put the dangerous dogs and the welfare cases closer to the beginning of the meeting. I think it would help a lot with the staffing. You know, having the staff to sit here for. I mean, it wouldn't hurt anything. I'd like to make a motion that we do
also
that.
Also, that they hear it. You're saying, so if they hear it at the beginning.
So, yeah, because if they're going to be here, we might as well accommodate them by putting it higher on the agenda.
I don't have a problem with that. Anybody else?
So I'd like to make a motion that we move the animal welfare and dangerous animal cases up maybe below the operations report. So I can work somewhere else.
Above the management report?
Or, after the call to the audience.
I second
it. All in favor? Or any discussion? No discussion, all in favor? Aye. Unanimous again?
Yes. We're very grateful tonight.
Yes. Okay. I want to backtrack. I didn't get the management report in. Went directly into the topics. So, Mr. James, did you have a management report that you wanted to share?
Other than the report that's in the writing section before, I don't have anything to add. I'm just trying to do it. And it's pretty late now, so I don't know. And I do not have any other unless okay. Unless there's questions on the board.
Okay. As Ms. Lesher said, there's been 1,821 individuals gave $114,509 in donations. That's unprecedented. That much money.
My question for that one is, based on what Ms. Lester said, is it just individuals or is it individuals and organizations and businesses?
That includes everything we get to include $29,000 from PetSmart charities and other specials. Any cash donations we receive are included in that, private, public, nonprofit, whatever it is. We noticed $114,000 plus this month. We ran a couple of appeals, another direct result of our fund development. Director doing a great job what she does. And these donations, and I appreciate the question earlier about expenses. The expenses are mainly for the bigger costs associated with our recent increases in spay neuter and in medical. Of course, some of them are specific to what on there, what they're for. When it comes to donations for SAMS fund, which is medical, offset medical expenses, and spay neuter, offset our spay neuter expenses associated with the community spay neuter program, not the operation of the PAC spay neuter. The general donations have increased significantly. That was a philosophical change based upon our fund development director's recommendation. It's probably a better way to go, and it's proven to be so. And again, many of those will be used again, though we can use it for anything. The focus is spay neuter and medical expenses that we're required to have. So at this point, that's the general protocol and philosophy of using our donations.
Thank you. We had three complaints and one commendation received by staff in December. Before I go to the last call in the audience, as far as under announcements, are there any, I want to do that now. Are there any announcements? Mr. James?
I just wanted to remind everybody that we, the Humane Society, have a grant to provide free spay, neuter, and vaccinations to dogs, puppies, in 85705. So if you know anybody, let them know.
I saw the advertisements on TV, but they didn't specifically say 85705. They were just saying from the Humane Society about spay and neuter.
I'm glad you got to see that commercial.
Ms. Engdahl.
I'm going to back up and do a commendation. And whoever set up the online licensing renewal, thank them, please. It was so easy to do. I did it yesterday, typed in one number, and both dogs came up. And it was just a dream. I mean, licensing staff has always been great, but I thought, oh great, I'm going to have to fight the computer and get one in and then put another. It was all done. And one swap bed, and it was just great. Thank you.
Also, you know, we're always concerned about dogs going to the wrong people with the adoption. Counselors and staff just forcing dogs out the door. Well, I can vouch that even today I saw the adoption counselor herself, you know, was out assisting. There was one volunteer there, so she was out assisting that volunteer as far as with the adoptions, and she actually saw her turn down someone because she felt that they were not, they should not have a dog. And those individuals were rather forceful wanting to have a dog, and she said no. she was very professional, and she just denied them the dog, so that made me feel pretty good. But I would have been concerned had I saw a dog go out with those people. So she did not.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, maybe just real quick. Tomorrow morning, starting at 8 o'clock right here in this venue, is the Pima Alliance for Animal Welfare General Meeting for all interested individuals, parties, groups, agencies in the animal welfare in our community. And it starts at 8, goes till noon. There'll be feedback on their three primary focus groups and opportunities to provide input and join the team.
Do you think that might be a good time to bring up what we're talking about as far as the city of Tucson possibly not wanting to pay anything?
It would.
Okay.
And are they also going to be adopting this love, adopt local?
Yes, that's one of the main focus that we talked about. I personally haven't heard yet, but we'll make sure you get that word.
We
want to
do an education booth.
Understood. Okay. Yep.
All right.
They did send out information for people who wanted booths. So
the ladies in the rep shop, they got something like that. But we don't, as you know, we don't adopt out animals as a general rule. It's medical care, and when we do adopt that animal, that's rare. So that people may not be aware that we fall within this plan that we do educate.
They're hoping for maneuvers just like that.
So that's, yeah, I think it's have good information on that insurance.
Okay, let me do the last call to the audience. If anybody wants to speak, please fill out one of these forms. Is there anyone out No? Okay. With that, the next meeting is scheduled for February 19th. Do we want to have that meeting here, or do we want to have it at that meeting? I thought there was going to be more people, and I don't know why we decided to have it out here.
The topics that are coming up are the ones that we've had a lot of issues being addressed, so what does the committee decide? Maybe we've had, we scheduled and split the agenda.
Well, there'll be a lot of topics. Right now, we didn't have, on old business, we'll bring back all those old topics that we didn't actually finish, and then work through them. But yeah, you're right. A lot of those topics have a lot of people's interests, so we may want to have it out here.
One more.
Yes, Tom?
Are we going to decide when we're going to have the emergency meeting?
No, I was going to wait until she, until Ms. Lesher sends me something, and I'll send something to Mr. James.
Okay. There's one more.
Okay, we wanted to find out first if we want to have the meeting
here.
Yes? Yes, okay. Mr. James, do you request this?
True.
There's one other issue. It's not really a committee stage, and it doesn't really concern, it doesn't concern this committee. We are meeting with people concerning service on emotional therapy dogs, how to handle this, people's needs in the community, working with some agencies. We will be meeting later this month. If somebody wants to know some more information, I can get you information on it. Trying to keep the number down. But if you've got any concerns, you can send me an email and I'll bring it forward to you. As I said, this is just kind of, right now we're kind of on a fact-finding type and trying to set up some policies or our thoughts, because it's a type of situation. So we're finding more and more people are coming up with service animals or emotional support animals. And in lieu of a national TV program, it's just come out. We're concerned about it. And so there's a group of us that are meeting on this later this month. So if anybody has any questions or anything like that, you can email me.
Okay. See, I'm getting a lot of requests for not just PTSD, but also emotional that has nothing to do with PTSD.
Right. Okay.
So, yeah.
All right. So
I probably would like more information.
Okay, sounds good. I know that we do have another organization that has expressed concern. It's not Top Dog, but it's another one that deals with training of animals that is also seeing an increase, and they have asked to be included in these talks.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah,
probably
be good.
Great.
Okay, with that, this meeting is adjourned.